subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
A cargo vessel sent by SpaceX called the Dragon capsule has docked with the International Space Station this weekend. The uncrewed vessel carries the usual supply and food and fruits for the crew, but it also carries high-tech solar panels for the International Space Station itself and some very interesting biological experiments. In this video, let's discuss a little bit about one specific biological experiment that is currently flying on the ISS, which has to do with bioluminescence in squid. I'm Sandhya Ramesh and this is Pure Science. Perhaps one of the most interesting experiments on board right now has to do with this bioluminescent squid and the process of bioluminescence in space. The species of squid is the bobtail squid. Most of us have seen images of these squid, even if we cannot place them immediately. They're tiny and shiny and really cute. They're actually also called dumpling squid or stubby squid because of how rounded they are in shape as compared to other squid. These bobtail squid, they have a symbiotic relationship with bioluminescent bacteria. The species of bacteria, Ally Vibrio fishery, live inside the squid's body. They specifically live in the mantle, which is the central body of the squid, away from the tentacles. Inside the mantle, there are things called light organs. This light organ of a squid is, of course, different from its eye. The light organ produces light. And inside a squid's light organ live these bioluminescent bacteria, which produce the light. So the bobtail squid and the bioluminescent bacteria live together in a symbiotic relationship. We might recall from school times that symbiosis is mutual interdependence of two species on each other, pretty much in a simplified way. And in this case, the squid actually house the bacteria. So it's a case of endosymbiosis where the bacteria live inside the body of a squid. This species of bacteria is commonly found living in symbiosis with various other marine animals as well. So how does the relationship work? It's easy to tell between the two which one is getting the benefit of food and nutrients here. Microorganisms are the ones that typically break down sugars and nutrients from larger plants and animals. So the bacteria that inhabit the squid's bodies are the ones that live in nutrient-rich environments and derive their energy and nutrients from the glucose that the squid produces. In turn, the bacteria offer the squid the benefit of protection. These squid, they inhabit open waters, right? And when there are creatures swimming in open waters, how do predators hiding in the deeper, darker layers of water below them spot them? By looking up and seeing them as they move and block out the light and cast a shadow. So, what the bioluminescent bacteria do is that they light up the squid, especially the squid's underside, so that it does not cast a shadow at all and sort of blends in with the light source in the background when viewed from below. So, any predators lurking below will not be able to spot its movements in the dynamic waters. This is a form of camouflage involving light and it is called counter-illumination, very self-explanatory. Many squids' bodies and mantles actually have reflective plates as well, which are made up of reflective proteins called reflectins, which reflect the light much more on the mantle, causing the squid to look iridescent. So this is how these two creatures live in symbiosis together, and this is the relationship that scientists are hoping to study and observe in detail. Researchers first of all hope to find out how these creatures will function in microgravity. Is the presence of gravity a contributing factor to how the symbiosis works and how the creatures interact with each other? If there's no gravity, the squid will grow slightly larger and might undergo slight anatomical modifications. So what happens to the light organs and how do the bacteria colonize them? Which brings us to how the bacteria come to inhabit the light organ in the first place. The fishery enter the light organ from the outside, from seawater, and they actually don't pass down from mother to offspring through vertical transmission. This is not transmission in terms of the virus, virology, or aerosol spread. This is in terms of genetics and reproduction. Vertical transmission occurs when the symbiote passes from the mother to the offspring, but that is not the case in these animals. The bacteria actually colonize newly hatched squid's light organs. And how do the bacteria find a newly hatched squid? Because symbiosis is initiated immediately upon hatching, and the bacteria are actually quite common in seawater all around squid. Because remember, this is a marine bacteria that is found living in symbiosis with other sea animals as well. But these bacteria also come out from other squid. Every single day, every morning, the squid clean their light organs, and they do this by expelling 90% of all bacteria that are in the light organ in a process that is called venting. Because squid vent every day, newly hatched squid immediately have access to a large amount of these bacteria. So scientists are hoping to study the process of daily venting as well as reproduction among these squid in space as well. During the process of colonization, the bacteria are actually selectively pulled in by the cilia or the hairs inside the animal's light organ. The cells on these hairs are highly favorable environment for the bacteria to grow and thrive. So the bacteria's growth is promoted. This induces physical or morphological changes in the squid's light organ too. But very interestingly, the changes are induced in the squid's light organ only after the bacteria first display bioluminescence. So the ability to luminescence is a requirement to induce these morphological changes in the squid, which then facilitate long-term symbiotic relationship. Once some bacteria are in the light organ, they start multiplying rapidly. The squid also is selective only to this species of bacteria and rejects all other competition. So the process is quite smooth. Once the bacteria colonizes the light organ enough, it then actually causes the cells on the cilia of the light organ to die off. So this is how the process occurs on Earth. This is how it is expected to occur in space, and scientists will study this process in space in microgravity or free fall to observe if there are any changes. The bacteria ally Vibrio fishery has a couple of unusual stories associated with it. Firstly, half the scientists refuse to call it that. They still call it Vibrio fishery in accordance with the older naming scheme, where it was classified under the genus Vibrio as opposed to the new one, the ally Vibrio, which was created in 2007. Then there's Hawaii. So bobtail squid are actually Hawaiian bobtail squid, and Hawaii has been trying to make this ally Vibrio fishery bacteria its state microbe since 2014. There was another bacteria in competition as well called the Flavobacterium Akia invivens, which was originally isolated from the Hawaiian shrub Akia. And there were two bills, both proposing to make a bacteria the state microbe, but both were unfortunately rejected in 2017. So what are some other experiments on board the ISS right now? There are thousands and thousands of water bears or tardigrades that were also sent on this Dragon. We've seen in a previous video about extremophiles and how they can live in extreme conditions. So these microscopic tardigrades will be studied in space to see how they survive in microgravity and vacuum. There's also an experiment with dental plaque and bacteria and toothpaste. This will study how the dental and oral bacteria survive in space, and thus it will help us understand astronauts' dental health better. There's also a very important upgrade that is flown on the space station currently, and that's the high-tech solar panels. The new ones will be additional panels that will be installed outside the station. So a couple of the seven astronauts who are currently on board will have to perform two spacewalks to install these solar panels on either side of the space station. We can actually see these solar panels on ISS from Earth even with the naked eye. If we look at an image of ISS, we can see that the solar panels are on either side. They look like protruding arms and they rotate so that they can capture sunlight no matter what time of the day it is. So when we see the ISS passing in the sky, we can actually see the spinning solar panels, and they even show up in a helical shape in photos. And the next time that we look towards the sky to see the ISS and its reflective solar panels with our naked eyes, we can also remember that there are lots of tiny, very cute and also very reflective iridescent squid that are living up there with the astronauts.